if it be your will. Let a voice be true from this broken hill. I will sing to you.
Now for today's program. Marcia Pally teaches at New York University and held the Mercator Professorship in the Theology Faculty of Humboldt University, Berlin, where she is an annual guest professor. Her book, Commonwealth and Covenant, Economics, Politics, and Theologies of Relationality, was selected by the United Nations Committee on Education for Justice for worldwide distribution. Her book, White Evangelicals and Right-Wing Populism, How Did We Get Here?, will be released next month. Professor Pally has been a columnist and contributor to U.S. and European periodicals, including Religion News Service, Religion and Ethics, and the New York Times, among many others. Professor Pally is the author of From This Broken Hill I Sing to You, God, Sex, and Politics in the Work of Leonard Cohen. Erica Jong is a celebrated poet, novelist, and essayist with over 27 published books that have been influential all over the world. Erica's most popular novel, Fear of Flying, celebrates its 49th anniversary this year. Never out of print, it has sold over 35 million copies in over 50 languages, including Chinese and Arabic. Erica's poetry has appeared in publications worldwide, including The New Yorker, LA Times, The Paris Review, Haaretz, and many more. Letty Cottin Pogrebin is a writer and social justice activist. She is a founding editor of Ms. Magazine and has served as a Moment columnist for more than 30 years. Her articles and op-eds have appeared in dozens of periodicals, including The New York Times, Washington Post, and The Nation. Letty is the author of 12 books, including Deborah, Golda, and Me, Being Female and Jewish in America. Her latest book, Shonda, A Memoir of Shame and Secrecy, will be published in September. Please welcome Marcia Pally, Erica Jong, and Letty Cottin Pogrebin.
We're talking here today about soothsayer, poet, musician, and to some, rabbi, Leonard Cohen. I'd like to begin by sharing with you some of the key wisdoms I learned studying his work for my book, From This Broken Hill, I Sing to You. Erica and Letty will then elaborate with comments as we explore the beautiful and the broken in his lyrics and poems. In verse and in prose, Leonard Cohen gave voice to a vision of how the world works and of the consequences we violate its foundational structure. In short, he explained how we got to the loss, loneliness, poverty, and violence that we see around us, what he called divisions of every sort, something I'm sure we're thinking a lot about this week as we watch the situation in the Ukraine. Cohen was a serious student of the Buddhist and Sufi traditions, but his theistic beliefs were Jewish. As he's told Stina Dabrowski in 1997, "I was always happy with the religion I was born into, and it satisfied all the religious questions." It was these religious questions that gave Cohen his understanding of the world's foundation. We live in a relational universe and are covenantal creatures. We become who we are through our covenantal relationships with the transcendent, which Cohen called God, and with each other. Importantly for Cohen, relationships with women. Cohen thought of women sexually, but also in the Kabbalist mystical tradition, as portals to the spiritual oneness with the divine. To the extent that we jettison, abandon, or transgress these entwined commitments to God and to others, in our personal or political lives, we undermined the very workings of the world, and no good comes of that. Cohen expressed his understanding of our need for relationship with God in the 1984 Book of Mercy, Cohen's modern Book of Psalms, his Tehillim. Quote, "We are made to lift my heart to you, God, travel on a hair to you, go through a pinhole of light and fly on the wisp of a remembrance to you." In turn, the 1973 Please Don't Pass Me By illustrates our simultaneous bonds with others. I brushed up against the man in front of me. I felt a cardboard placard on his back. It said, "Please don't pass me by. I am blind, but you can see I've been blinded totally. Please don't pass me by." Passing others by precludes seeing and seeing to them. It forecloses attending to our connection to them, however close or attenuated. It makes us blind. And again, no flourishing can come of that. As for Cohen and women, there's a trove, starting with Suzanne in his first song collection. And you want to travel with her, and you want to travel blind, and then you know that you can trust her, for she's touched your perfect body with her mind. From body to mind and spirit, an idea that appears on Cohen's first album and on everyone since. All this devotion to God, to others, to lovers, and yet, though we are made for relationship, Cohen knew that we breach relationship daily in our personal and political lives. Inconstancy, betrayal, abandonment, self-interest, and self-protection are the human condition. Cohen was unable to stay constant to God and so find peace with himself. He stayed no more constant to the women he loved. Cohen knew himself to be a covenant failure par excellence. "I made a date in heaven," he sang. "Oh Lord, I've been keeping it in hell." What gets in the way of keeping covenant? Everything human. We think some self-interest is better and safer than the bonds of covenantal regard. We follow the call of Babylon and Boogie Street, sexual adventure or economic game, two running themes in Cohen's work. Cohen bonded and bolted with women, love him and leave him, for two reasons. One, fear that women would not give him access when he wanted it. Quote, he sang, "But you stand there so nice in your blizzard of ice, so please let me into the storm." Secondly, that once given access, women would overwhelm his autonomy and independence. So he bolted. As Cohen himself put it in a 1988 interview, quote, "The condition that most elevates us is the condition that most annihilates us, that somehow the destruction of the ego is involved with love." Or so he feared. In the 1984, Night Comes On, Cohen wrote one of his most self-revealing lines. "I needed so much to have nothing to touch. I've always been greedy that way. To be free of needing to touch, how tempting hermeticism is." Who's responsible for our yo-yo between covenant and breach? On one hand, Cohen faults himself and humanity. The song Avalanche, 1971, is the story of God's covenantal offer to his children and his sorrow at our forsaking it. In the body of Jesus, a figure important for Cohen as someone fully human who did not fail covenant. In the body of Jesus, God steps into the avalanche of human life. He is not embraced, but abandoned, and so God laments. "You, humanity, say you've gone away from me, but I can feel you breathe. It is your turn, beloved. It is your flesh that I wear." God, having stepped into human flesh to love and secure humanity, hopes still that we will step up and return covenant. "Hey, baby, it's your turn." On the other hand, Cohen faults not only humanity, but God. Why did God make us relational and yet so easily able to sever relationship? Why are we so on our own to forsake and be forsaken? Why have each of us out there dangling, as Cohen sang, like a bird on a wire, trying to be free, having torn everyone who reached out for me? Cohen's lover, lover, lover encapsulate his ire at God. He, God, said, "I locked you in this body. I meant it as a kind of trial." In this song, God admits that he, author of creation, is the author of our trials. He made us for committed love, yet gave us bodies, wandering desires that betray it. What kind of rigged trial is that? What kind of God? Cohen's diagnosis of our political sins continues the covenantal theme. We breach and abandon covenant not only in our personal lives, but along the political paths of our global connectedness. And we don't breach commitment to God, lovers, and in politics one by one. We do it all at once. God, lovers, others, Cohen's dark trinity. The 1988 song, Everybody Knows, is a template for Cohen's politics. It begins with our betrayals in the political realm. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. Cohen then slithers into the unfaithfulness of love. Everybody knows you've been discreet, but there were just so many people you had to meet without your clothes and everybody. The image of the betraying lover then moves to the betrayed God, who was abandoned at Calvary and is discarded again daily. From the bloody cross on top of Calvary to the beach of Malibu, everybody knows it's coming apart. Take one look at this sacred heart before it blows, and everybody knows. Mm-hmm. We betray God on the cross and on sunny beaches, with covenant thrice tranced in politics, love, and faith, the world is ready to blow. Indeed, what bonds remain to hold it together? At the end of his life, Cohen came to no tidy resolution, but perhaps to two things. First, a recognition of the woman behind the desired and feared icon, and two, some recognition of the entwined covenant with God, with persons, an acceptance of the paradox that God made us relational and yet so easily able to trance relationship, to abandon. First, to the woman. In 2006, he told Christine Langlois, "I never met a woman until I was 65. Instead, I saw all kinds of miracles in front of me." And the dazzling, unencounterable icon. Langlois continues that Cohen loved women through his own urgent needs and desires, she writes. And Cohen told her, "Once that started to dissolve, I began to see the woman standing there." This insight was owed in part to his relationship with Anjani Thomas, which gave him a glimpse of the female subject, one who is not just the object of his desire and ire. A Street, written with Thomas in 2014, introduces for the first time the female I. Thomas and Cohen write, "You left me with the dishes and the baby in the bath. The party's over, but I've landed on my feet." Here's the woman in her own voice, not a recruit for male needs and fears. Second, to the recognition of the entwined covenant and acceptance of the paradox that God made us relational, yet easily able to break relationship. His last song collection, You Want It Darker, released 3 weeks before his death, encapsulates the struggle of his 60 years of writing. I'll focus on the title song, You Want It Darker, in which Cohen writes, "Magnified, sanctified, be thy holy name. Vilified, crucified in the human frame. A million candles burning for the help that never came. You want it darker. We kill the flame." Mm-hmm. The first line, "Magnified, sanctified, be thy holy name," is recited, among other places, in the Hebrew prayer mourners say for the dead. Cohen here is sarcastic. This is the God we magnify and sanctify, a God who allows vilification and crucifixion and whose help never comes. Why lay our souls in his hands? And what kind of inscrutable God wants his world darker, making us, his dependent creatures, do the dirty work and kill the flame. Yet the second part of the refrain puts an end to anger. It turns to openness towards the transcendent. Cohen sings, "Hineni, hineni, I am here, present for you," which Cohen addresses to God. After a life of ricocheting between bond and breach, Cohen comes to "Hineni, I am here for you." This is Cohen in relationship, who understands that God is the healer, whom he sought and resisted throughout life, and that God is now taking him out of it. With that summary of some of the themes in From This Broken Hill, I'd like to hear from Letty and Erica their comments, their questions, and we'll dive into a conversation about all this material.
I am so happy to be with you, Marcia, and Erica, who I've known probably for 50 years. But most of all, I love this book and I want to promote it. This is what it looked like. And it's a fantastic picture of Leonard on the cover. I've always listened to Leonard Cohen as a woman and a Jew, a conscious woman and a conscious Jew, not just passive. Leonard Cohen was introduced to me by Leonard Nimoy, who was an old friend. And Leonard Nimoy was transgressive in his own way after being an actor, and everyone knows him from Star Trek. He became an art photographer and he published a book of photographs called Shekhinah. He had naked women with tefillin wrapped around them. He included imagery that was so shocking that he was actually rejected from a lecture date that he was supposed to arrive at a synagogue. He was considered so dangerous somehow or other. But as a woman, I've always struggled with the fact, again, this is about contradictions, which you have laid out so beautifully for us, Marcia. I've struggled with my love of this man's music as a Jew and my discomfort with his life in terms of his relationships with women. Women to him, as you said, are miracles, they're muses, they're idealized, they're sometimes deified. And then of course, he discovers that we're human. A pedestal is a very small place. It's a prison. A pedestal is a prison. And he put women on pedestals. And of course, you have to fall off. You fall off. You have premenstrual tension. You have a bad day. You want him to do something he does badly. And he disappoints and you get angry. And suddenly, you're no longer divine. So his inability to relate on a real level always troubled me. His focus on the physical, solely the physical, until he was 65 and discovered that women were real, had a human quotient as much as men. I have resolved the contradiction by just kind of diving into the kind of visceral gut level love I have for the music and the depth of the thinking. I know I'll have a lot of opportunity to speak specifically, but I just wanted to raise one interesting dynamic, which is the book ends again with contradiction that are so clear to me in Everybody Knows and then The Guests. The Guests was written in 1979, and it could be entitled No One Knows, because all of the refrain is no one knows, no one knows, and then Everybody Knows is Everybody Knows and Everybody Knows. So are we to think that in 9 years he flipped his consciousness or reframed? Also, the bookends of I'm your man, and if it be your will, is Kein hi ratzon, may it be your will, which is part of our prayers. It's very Jewish to me. And it's obviously, it's about an acceptance, a kind of submissiveness. I'm your man is that same thing toward a sexual partner. I'll do anything for you. Yet there are promises I couldn't keep. The contradiction with I'll do anything at the, for the God content, Kein yehi ratzon, may it be your will, I'll give up my voice for you, that sacrifice, and I'll do anything for you as a woman. I just love the interplay. Marcia calls it a kind of double, what do you call it? Doubling, right, Marcia?
Right.
Doubling. So I just wanted to introduce into everyone's thinking the notion of contradiction, the fact that there is so much Christianity, but and yet for me, he is a totally Jewish, at least a presence in my life. He's a totally right. Jewish presence in my life. When I think about him and his music, he's uber Jew. And the fact that his politics is always so intertwined with love and sex and faith. And he's so rich that you could study him like the Talmud. There's no end to it. Like the Torah, turn it. Everything is in it. Erica.
Letty, I think you've described so well why he haunts us. The longing for love and yet the ambivalence when we get it and our inability to fulfill our longing for love. And that's why his music and lyrics move us. And you really described it perfectly. And I think that songs that tell the story of our imperfections and our ambivalence are the songs we remember. And that for me is Leonard Cohen.
Marcia, talk a little bit about winning and losing, how he played winning and losing. That when he gave up winning, he found peace. In a way, that was the only reassurance I had that he had figured something out, finally, that there was closure on a thought, right, on all the contradictions. Can you speak to that, Marcia?
Thanks to both of you very much for paying such close attention to From This Broken Hill. Letty, I'm not sure that he came to any resolution to his contradictions. Maybe an acceptance of the contradiction, but not an untangling of the contradiction. And you've mentioned so many of them and pulled them out so well from the book. He did put women on a pedestal in his desire and adoration, not only for them physically, but as some Kabbalist path to spiritual oneness with God. Yet in real life, relationships don't feel that way all the time. And not only did he get frustrated by daily living, he felt and feared being constrained and overwhelmed. Very common that his autonomy and his intactness would be punctured by the demands of intimacy. And he, As I studied his poems and his two novels and his lyrics, what I saw was, as you pointed out, this repeating pattern. I desire spiritual oneness with God and can't sustain it. I desire oneness with my lovers and can't sustain it. I get angry, I get frustrated, and I leave.
But isn't that the human dilemma, that we aspire to a kind of perfect love and unity, but we fall away from it? We can't always do it. So it's always a process of attempting rather than fulfilling. That's the essence.
Yep.
And
yep.
I find that so moving.
Yep. Yeah. And I find in Anthem, there's a kind of literary embodiment of imperfection. In there's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in.
I love that.
It's the greatest line. I mean, I have so many lines of his that sort of live in my mind as axioms, I guess. And he writes, and he writes and sings about forget your perfect offering. Now, the offering has different connotations in Judaism and Christianity. What offering brings to mind for me is Isaiah, in which, you know, Isaiah says, you know, forget your burnt offering, your perfect offering. It's kind of like, I don't need sacrifice. I need you to pay attention to the poor and the orphan and the widow.
Mm-hmm.
That's what God wants. And in Christianity, it's the perfect, it's the Holy Spirit, it's the dove, it's the purity, the pure. But the crack in everything has probably been quoted back to me and all the rest of the people who are watching this. It's a line that saves us in hard moments. There's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. I mean, when you're down,
that's how the light gets through.
Yeah, that's how the light gets in.
And such a beautiful and true impression.
Yeah, and his lines, his so frequently repeated lines have to do with light and darkness. He's mm-hmm. he's considered, you know, the bard of darkness or some such phrase. And yet there's so much light in his lyrics now and then that
right.
It's dazzling. It's dazzling.
I think there is light in this poet of the dark and despair, because of what Erica said a moment ago. It is about attempting in the face of not succeeding. And the question is, can you stick around to keep attempting? I think that why so many of us all around the world for half a century have been so captivated by Leonard Cohen is that he was willing to reveal every jot and tittle of his flaws, of his of his faults, of his inabilities, of his crises, of his crankiness, of his anger, his irrationality that he knew was irrational, cranky, angry, and flawed. And we're very fortunate that someone of such great literary talent was willing to reveal all of this about himself so that we can learn about ourselves through his revelation. And Letty, I'm so glad that you brought up the question of the doubled imagery. I have a whole chapter on the doubled imagery, because if we read so many of his lines, we will see that it could be addressing a woman or God, or both at the same time. And that's the point for Leonard Cohen, that our human relationships with others, with lovers, are of the same dilemma as our relationships with God. We want it, we seek it, we leave it.
And yeah. We push it away at the same time. And that is the human dilemma, that we have this great need to love, which we do so imperfectly. And we know how imperfect we are. That's, I think, why the lyrics are so moving.
Yeah. He had a great quote in one of his interviews, that he said his ability to write songs is rooted in some inspired confusion of womanhood, godliness, beauty, and darkness. And then
that's so beautiful.
I know. And then he said, I love to sing to him and her. The him, I believe, is a capital letter. I don't remember if he was speaking it or writing it, but to me, it's a capital letter, the conflation of God and woman. Yeah. And both disappoint. Well, that gets you into the theodicy, and free will. You know, God could make everything perfect if God wanted to, but God would then have, you know, made us into puppets who do everything that God wants us to do. And rather, we rather be people of free will who make mistakes and have moral agency than we would to be perfect. Frankly, we'd all be quite boring if we were perfect.
That's why, Letty, people ask why I begin the book with a quick overview of major theodical principles. Theodicy being the problem is, why does God, who is perfect and all-powerful, permit so much brutality and loss and pain? Why is that? And people through the ages have tried to answer it with varying degrees of lack of success. And yet those are the questions in his work. God, I fail you. Woman, I fail you. Politically, I fail. God, why do you let that happen? And I think this is a good place for us to take a break and listen to one or part of one of the songs that brings this all together. His anger, his beseeching God, and his at the setup of the world that God has made. And it's entitled Lover, Lover, Lover. And I think we're going to hear part of it now. Mm-hmm.
Father, change my name. The one I'm using now, it's covered up with fear and filth and cowardice and shame. Yeah.
I just want to tell people who don't realize it that the African-American woman who was one of the backup singers is Sharon Robinson. And he was so respectful of her. He recognized her talent. He co-wrote several of his lyrics with her. And he never had an affair with her. Am I right, Marcia? Yeah, he never had an affair with her, which raises the issue of Judy Collins, who's a friend of Erica's and mine as well. Judy, I spoke to her last night just to make sure that she didn't want to admit to me something she did not admit in her autobiography. She did not have an affair with him. She was central in terms of establishing his career. She's the one who said, "You can sing." She's the one who pulled him back on stage when he suddenly got stage fright and everything was crashing. And then he's the one who said to her, "You can write songs. Why are you singing other people's songs?" So, I mean, here's another part of him where he uplifted Sharon Robinson. He uplifted Judy Collins. And yet he doesn't see the full humanity of some of these other women. Also, one thing about that song, in the first line, I asked my father, I said, "Father, change my name, the one I'm using now, it's covered up with fear and filth and cowardice and shame." In Judaism, at least in shtetl Judaism and Hasidic Judaism still, people change their names to change their destiny. Mostly what they do it when they're sick and their soul is imperiled. They change their names in order to beat out the devil, the evil eye, the ayin hara. They think, well, if I change, my mother's name was changed when she had whooping cough and almost died. She was born in a shtetl. Her name was changed from Sarah to Cyril. Cyril is a fairly grand name for a little Jewish girl from a Hungarian shtetl. So the idea of how his words resonate in the weirdest way for each of us. So for me, it raised the changing of my mother's name. For me, there's a line about a mask in which song I forgot, I'll wear a mask for you, I'm your man, and I'm your man, and that I'll wear a mask for you raises, okay, Republican lover, Democratic lover, I'll wear a mask for you. And then there's a line about, isn't it amazing, everything that he writes.
You really described it so beautifully.
It's what he does for us, is give us an entry point, a gateway into some contemporary issue. Even the word plague, and I forgot which song, Marcia will know, it was written about AIDS, but now it's about us.
Right. So,
I mean, exactly. It's kind of what, as I said.
The ambivalence of being a human being. It's amazing and so beautiful.
It is.
The mark of a great artist, and the reason why I spent a number of years reading this, is that the imagery goes on and continues to show us through lenses and through crystals the life that goes on beyond the day that the song was written. And in Lover, 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 two, of course, immediate questions. I ask my father, who's the father? God, biological father. And this is Leonard admitting, how do I feel about myself? Cowardice, fear, and shame. This is Leonard knowing that he is breaking commitments right and left and not sustaining the bonds that he knows are necessary for the world to work. And he knows he's not doing his bit.
Talk about his father and his grandfather in terms of raising father, because they were powerful figures, and his uncle, I think.
I just want to just say one more thing about the song before we leave it. Lover, 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 come back to me. That is also, many, many lines in Cohen that applies to both God and woman at once. I will share with the audience my favorite example of the—
Which is that?
Of God and woman is, take this longing from my tongue.
That's great. That's so great.
So beautiful.
So Letty, to the question you asked, Cohen's father, who owned a department store in Montreal, died when Cohen was 9. And it's very interesting, a story that I tell in From This Broken Hill, that that after the funeral, little Leonard took a bow tie from his father's drawer and cut one of the wings of the bow tie and buried the broken bow tie in the family yard. And asked later why he did that, he said he didn't know. But I think the imagistic act is clear in and of itself. The men in his family, his grandfathers on both sides, were scholars of Judaism and very, very active, both in scholarship and in developing the Jewish community in Montreal and in Canada more broadly. And it's interesting that Cohen remained a not only devoted Jew, but passionately interested in Judaism. And he had what I call the half-assed years in the 60s and 70s of touring, but still lit the Sabbath candle, still celebrated the holidays. And then he had the very devoted years of studying Talmud, which is very difficult, and studying Bible and Jewish thinkers. I had the privilege to meet and to get to know and to befriend Mordechai Finley, who was Cohen's rabbi in the last years of his life. And Mordechai discussed with me what a serious scholar of Judaism Cohen was, which brings me back to something else that you mentioned, forget this perfect offering. And this I think is one of the pieces of wisdom that Cohen learned by watching himself strive for God and commitment and covenant and fail over and over again. He's a recidivist failure, you know, and it's Isaiah, it's Amos, it's Proverbs, it's Hosea, and they all say it through their prophetic voice that God does not want your perfect offering. He doesn't want your korbanot and the zvachim, the ritual offerings. He wants justice. Let justice roll down, at justice and mercy roll down like a river flowing. And this inability to sustain the commitment to that mm-hmm. kind of caring for others, seeing to others in justice, ways of justice, is how for Cohen, his relationship with God and failure, his relationships personally and their failures, and his relationships with in political situations, which again, I'm sure is very, very much on our minds this week, how they are all connected. And so maybe this is also a good time to hear a little bit of Everybody Knows, which mm-hmm. brings all three of these conundrums with God, with others, with lovers in the political realm. Mm-hmm. Maybe hear a little bit of that.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys are lost. Everybody knows that the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows.
I love that. You get that in that song. You get his humor, his irony, his sarcasm, political cynicism, the sex, you know. Mm-hmm. It's dark, it's pessimistic. He's saying everybody knows, but not enough people do.
Right.
The thing is about doing. It's about doing. And he's got that word, the broken feeling, always the brokenness. It's, you know, again, in Judaism, we know that inside the tabernacle were put the broken tablets along with the fully formed tablets that Moses brought down from Mount Sinai. We carry our brokenness with us. And Leonard Cohen has brokenness in probably half his songs. The word broken is in there somewhere. This for me is a very political song.
Yeah.
Beautifully put, Letty. Really beautiful.
Right. He says it's all in here. Racism is in here. You know, the boat is leaking. The war is over and the good guys lost. I mean, we're right in it.
Yeah.
What it means to be human.
Mm-hmm. I do want to point out again that the African-American woman in that was also Sharon Robinson, and that towards the end of his life, he and Sharon collaborated on a lot of work and right. songs that people may think are Leonard Cohen's were actually co-written by the two of them. And this is also why I've included this, because this song in this presentation, because it unifies these three areas of reach and brokenness throughout mm-hmm. life with God, lovers, and others, and they're all in this song. And he could be very insightful and very beautiful and very nasty. In the book, both in the chapter about women and in much of the writing about God, you can't whitewash Leonard Cohen. He's great because he let it all hang out there. For example, he could say about women he loved, here's the irony, women he loved and yet was afraid they would constrain him. He could say something this nasty. You know, there are just so many nice one-night stands. Do you really want to be the ditch around the tower? And that's very nasty. The echo of bitch around male arousal is unavoidable. And when he could be very, very angry at God, very angry at women, and accusatory, and willing to write about it, so that we also could see how much of the human condition these nasty, frustrated, angry, irrational emotions are, and how much they motivate us and how much we act on them. We say we're not going to do it again. We say we're going to do better. And sometimes we do, and a lot of the times we don't.
And often fall away from it.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, again, this is the issue of everybody knows and not, and doesn't do. And God could fix and doesn't fix.
Right.
You know, it's painful, but it's also, it's funny because we just know our frailties. We see our frailties in this lyric.
Yeah.
He covers everything, the sexual revolution, drugs, selling sex. He just manages to get it all in. And I don't know, to me, this is one of the greats. Everybody knows is one of the greats.
That's how the light gets in.
Yeah.
Well,
and this is the one that I said contrasts with the guest. So now that you have that refrain in your head of everybody knows, in the guests, it says, one by one, the guests arrive. The guests are coming through, the open-hearted many, the broken-hearted few, and no one knows where the night is going, and no one knows why the wine is flowing. Oh, love, I need you. I need you. I need you. Oh, I need you now. And then it's no one knows where the night is going through many, many stanzas in which we're back in the, you know, in the tension between knowing and not knowing, getting and longing and losing. It's just all in there, entangled beautifully.
I think
beautifully put, Letty.
Oh, Erica. Thank you.
In several of his later works, like Parallel to the Guests is also Closing Time, where he describes this bacchanal, this whiskey-driven sexual bacchanal, where the women take off their shirts and the men are dancing on their polka dots, and the booze is flowing and the drunken talk is blowing, and I'm paraphrasing. And yet it comes down to his talk to the boss.
Mm-hmm.
And yet another song where the political and the personal and the spiritual come together. And another song in which he's angry at the boss. He says, the boss doesn't like these dizzying heights. The gates of heaven opened and they budged an inch, and nothing much has happened since.
Mm-hmm.
In that song, he is angry at this sort of wasted human bacchanal, and yet angry at God for making us desirous, not liking our desire, not fixing this terrible mess. And on the other hand, Letty, I think you intimated that if God fixed the terrible mess, then we would be puppets, as the book opens by explaining. We would be pre-programmed dolls.
Mm-hmm. You make sense of all of this so beautifully in the book, Marcia. You, the way you've arranged the your thoughts into chapters. You know, it's very hard when you're starting to write and you have a project lying ahead of you to tease the order out of everything you know and everything you learn and everything you care about. And you've done it so brilliantly. For me, the most political of his songs are Everybody Knows, Democracy, and The Future.
Oh, yes.
What really strikes me about The Future is this line. I'm the little Jew who wrote the Bible. I've seen the nations rise and fall. I've heard their stories, heard them all. Yeah. And what I get out of that is this total knowingness of the Jewish condition. And he's a little Jew. And then I was amazed to discover that he's a short guy. He comes on so tall for me. And then I looked up and someone said he was like 5'7". Someone else said he was 5'9". He's not a towering figure. He is a little Jew, but he projects so much power and so much presence. And then he's really saying, you know, we wrote the Bible. You know, this is ours. This is ours. And we've survived. We've survived through our text and through our togetherness. We've survived as a people. That's what I get out of it. I don't know what Christians.
No, I agree with you.
It's very different.
Through writing, why is writing so important to us? Because it's a means of survival. Exactly.
The other interesting thing about Cohen, if we're going to continue just a moment with this meld of politics and the personal and the spiritual, he makes the same indictment of himself and of us that regarding not sustaining covenant with God and not sustaining covenant in our lives. He makes the same indictment in our political lives. Take, for example, in Anthem, he writes, I can't run no more with that lawless crowd while the killers in high places say their prayers out loud, and they're going to hear from me. You think from this that he's going to do something, and yet, crushingly, he also admits to not being up to it, not bothering, not getting it together. As he writes in The Land of Plenty, I don't really have the courage to stand where I must stand, don't really have the temperament to lend a helping hand. He was able to see the need for us to care for the other in our political lives, and able also to show his own and all of ours dereliction and failure in this, as in our spiritual lives.
He centers Sisters of Mercy, which sounds like a totally Catholic-inspired poem or lyric because of the Catholic Order of Nuns with that name. And when I really looked deeply into it, it looked like it had no Jewish allusions, but it really is about what the Torah is about, which is taking the lowest, finding value and dignity in the lowest, because it's about prostitutes, I think. Because there's a line that says, don't turn on the lights. You can read their address by the moon. They're the ladies of the night.
No, actually, this song, sorry, Letty. This song was written when he sort of gave shelter to two young female hitchhikers with whom he did not have sexual relations, and wrote the song while they were sleeping, and wrote a song about the mercy that the event, this kind of sweet event, gave and allowed him. I made my confession to them. That's one of the lines that allowed him human intimacy and perhaps a moment of spiritual intimacy. And one of the few songs where the sexual doesn't turn so quickly to anger. In that sense, it's like Suzanne, where the relationship, the intimate relationship with women does not turn to anger so quickly, which is also there in his work, as well as the admission of his own angers at his own angers at women and at God, as we've said, for leaving us in this predicament. As we've been going for about an hour, Letty, is there, are there one or two questions we may or may not have time for?
Well, I would love to see the questions. We'll take a look in the Q&A. Here's someone who says, can you talk a little bit about the posthumous book and videos? There seems to me to be yet another development of his concerns. And I'll group together a couple of questions. How would Leonard feel about the Jews experiencing danger in the Ukraine? And was he ever ordained as a rabbi? And another, do you equate his guests as a Buddha-like, looking for answers about why we suffer? And then there's a wonderful one, you know, just these to trigger you, Marcia. Was Cohen ever nominated or considered for the Nobel Prize in Literature or Poetry? He should have won instead of you know who. Someone says, did he have children? So you just to dive into those.
Sure. I'm also going to take a moment of shameless promotion to note that the link to the book on Amazon is in the chat if anyone wants to actually check out the book itself. And I will now dive into some of those questions. Yes, he had two children, and Lorca, named for Garcia Lorca, his lifelong poetic mentor, and Adam and Lorca. He was never ordained as a rabbi, but he did, as he did spend decades studying Buddhism, and spent 5 years. Mm-hmm. Monastery where he was ordained a Buddhist monk, which he was very clear about, did not and was never intended to displace his Judaism. He saw Buddhism as a discipline of the mind and of time, all those days and minutes and hours in those half-assed years of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. He sought a discipline of the mind and time, which he went to Buddhism for. But the worldview that we've been discussing about God is foundationally Jewish, although he took the figure of Jesus very seriously. The philosopher Babbitt Babich put it very well, that Cohen wanted us not to be Christians, but to get the point about Christ, about giving for the sake of others.
And who didn't break the covenant?
That giving for the sake of others is the result of not breaking the covenant. God or with others. The Nobel Prize, he was not, and I quite agree he should have gotten that when the unmentioned other did get it. But no, he didn't. Posthumous work, yes, a collection of drawings and poems, The Flame, was published posthumously. An album was put out as well, Thanks for the Dance. The songs in Thanks for the Dance were recorded at the same time as the 2016 song collection, You Want It Darker. And then Cohen, Leonard, and his son Adam made a selection and put them in You Want It Darker. But after Leonard Cohen died, his son made a second selection from that recording,
right,
and put it in Thanks for the Dance. And Thanks for the Dance is not nearly as dark as You Want It Darker. There are very few song collections that are as dark and as wise as You Want It Darker. Mm-hmm. But you'll see many of the same themes in the posthumous Thanks for the Dance as in his oeuvre from start to finish.
We have a bunch of additional questions if you feel ready to take them.
Yeah.
A couple of people asked about Leonard's relationship with his mother and what you think it taught him about women or how it influenced him. And people want us all to talk about Hallelujah, which we didn't touch on, strangely, because everybody, there's been a 300 interpretations. People have done covers on Hallelujah. We hear Hallelujah on Shabbat services and so on. So maybe you could say something about Hallelujah. And someone makes the point that you might want to share a link to independent booksellers who could use the support rather than Amazon, and you can do that through indie.com. Then a couple of other kind of biological questions. Did Cohen use, not biological, but biographical, did Cohen use drugs or hallucinogens? God, it's so long since I've thought about hallucinogens. I'd like to know his parents' relationship and how it influenced him. And again, the sexual imagery in Hallelujah. There's a bunch for you.
Okay, so Leonard Cohen had a strong and good relationship with his mother. As I said, his father died when he was nine. They sang together. And when he was in high school, they used to go out and sing with his friends, with his mother as well, at cafes and restaurants and so on. But the question of the influence of his mother on his relationship with women is interesting. Cohen has a number of biographies. Sylvie Simmons, one of his biographers, insightfully quotes Cohen, and I'm going to quote directly. My mother taught me never to be cruel to women. This is Sylvie Simmons. But what he also learned from Marcia, his mother, was to count on the devotion, support, and nurturing of women, and if and when it became too intense, to have permission to leave.
Wow.
And yet, so we've been talking about and leaving for a long time. And yet, although he seems to have gleaned this from his relationship with his mother, Cohen also understood this was a fault, a flaw, a problem, that it may be part of the human condition as a problem, but that it is a problem. He didn't think this was just grand. He knew it was a pattern of his, but he also knew that it was very problematic. Drugs, yes, 60s, music scene, what more needs to be said? But he also liked, let me see if I can get the, wait a minute. He also liked red wine. In particular.
Oh yeah, a very expensive one.
Yes, and I'm.
I remember that. When he was regaining his fortune, he started buying that wine. That very expensive French wine.
Hold on. I'm looking for wine labels.
You don't have to promote.
At the moment, I can't pull up the wine label, but we'll have to accommodate that. The Ukraine question wasn't addressed, and I think that Cohen would have understood the Ukraine the way he understood a great deal of our politics. We don't see to a situation, we don't see to what and take care of what is going on with others if it doesn't seem to be concerning us at the moment. And then the situation gets aggravated and exacerbated and then blows up. Big surprise. And we do it all the time. That we don't sustain, our political care for each other. And we live in an interconnected world. We always are influenced and impacted by the political situations close to us, but also those quite far away, especially in these global supply chains. What did we learn from COVID and our global trade and COVID, our global diseases? We cannot avoid our interconnectedness. And if we do, it blows up. And I think that if I can say something not from Leonard, that we have had so many lessons in just the last couple of years, that if we do not understand our interconnectedness, we are going to be a species that is just smart enough to kill itself off.
Yes.
We have climate change, we have COVID, and now we have potentially a military situation that could slip into a nuclear one. If we don't pay attention to what's going around the globe, it will surely come around to us.
Absolutely, so, right.
I'm getting a note from Suzanne Borden at moment that we need to wrap up. And so I would like to thank all of those who came to listen. Thank you very much. And I hope for those of you who take a dip into From This Broken Hill that you will enjoy and learn from Leonard Cohen's imagery, its beauty, its wisdom, its despair, and its light. I would also very, very much like to thank Letty and Erica for this wonderful conversation, and to thank everybody, Suzanne Borden, and everybody at Moment Magazine who made this talk possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Marcia and Letty and Erica, thank you so much for this wonderful, wonderful presentation. I think, Marcia, you have a new college course you could teach. And I think you have a lot of fans based on the Q&A and comments that would sign up for your class. So thank you for teaching.
I'm teaching this at Humboldt University in the coming semester.
Wonderful. Again, wonderful. As Marcia said, I encourage everybody to buy her book, From This Broken Hill, I Sing to You. I will be sending out a follow-up email later in the week that will include a link to the book as well as a link to the recording. If you can't wait for the email, you can find this on our website tomorrow morning. Please remember to go to momentmag.com and sign up for next week's Zoominar, which is Why Women Need to Pray at the Western Wall. Please note this will be at an earlier time slot because we have presenters from Israel. And again, thank you everybody for joining us, and we will see you next time.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.